First question, yes. Tell us who you are and what the question is.
My name is Israel Paimau, and my question concerns something that the Assemblyman Schaer just raised. Two issues. One is about working together, which I think is a really great thing, and the parties to work together. And the other point is about the shortage of money in the education and budget. And my question concerns whether, you know, there is a bill in New Jersey, the first in the country, actually, that's a real Milton Friedman bill, that, in fact, Assemblyman Michael Patrick Carroll, one of the sponsors, there's only six in the Assembly, a few in the Senate, and that would actually provide a universal school choice voucher for a fraction of what it's costing education, to be able to take it, you know, to a non-public school or to a public school, whatever. So there would be two things. It would be evenly spread around the state, the distribution of the state fund. My question is whether you would... there's a few Assemblymen,
The question is
whether you consider bringing together Assembly people and Senate people to support this, because the people at the top, I'm hearing from both sides of the aisle, are telling their people, don't do it. So I'm wondering if at the grassroots level, I mean, as far as in Trenton, I mean, if you would get together and basically do a political revolution and get this done. That's my question.
Yes.
We had a revolution over 200 years ago. Since then, this country's government is one of evolution. Change. Change in some areas is quicker than it is in other areas. Michael Patrick mentioned other states, what they're doing. Some are far advanced of New Jersey in terms of how we treat and deal with charter schools, with private, with public, with parochial. And some are far behind. I think to suggest using the Friedman model as something appropriate for New Jersey, although it might be interesting, I think its practicality is at best limited from either party's point of view. I don't believe that the leadership of my Democratic Party is in any way supportive, and I don't believe that the leadership of the Republican Party, certainly not wanting to speak for them, Tom and Michael Patrick could do that much better, but I don't believe that you'd find anyone of any real consequence in terms of leadership supporting that bill.
I think there's
in a deference to Michael Patrick.
I think there's a far better way we can allocate the school funding formula. SFRA, when it was first done, really did a disservice to special needs funding, among other areas. And one of the things that's impacting people across this state and every single zip code is the impact of that formula on special needs education in the state of New Jersey and the affordability of that education. So that's my hope is in short order we can change the school funding formula to better reflect an outcomes approach, and that's one of the areas that we need to do between now and June, my hope is. My other hope is an issue like the Park exam, which many of my daughter just took the Park exam. It's one of the best across the state, tests to figure out, measure apples to apples, what's working and what's not, and then you can get better information into the hands of parents over the course of the next couple of months to figure out what systems are working, what are not, and if we can use that as a tool, then we can work together on a bipartisan basis to get educational opportunity in every single building. There are some schools that are doing extraordinarily well in the public education system, but too frequently, right down the street in the exact same zip code, there are buildings that aren't doing a good job. Sometimes that's leadership. Sometimes there are a variety of factors lead into that, but we've got to get as much information in the hands of parents as humanly possible so they know that they've got the opportunity to make a difference in their kids' lives.
I just add one thing, and that is Democrats and Republicans can work together. They can get things done. The charter school bill is an example of when we did that. You have people here, three legislators who know how to work together. Sometimes the perception that's created by the media, and I can pick on them, is not necessary to the truth. And it's necessary to get together and work. And the other part that's important to understand is compromise, in the end, works. And that's how charter schools got done. Yes? Your name and...
My name's Bob.
Okay, Bob. Want everybody to know who you are. Go ahead.
thank you for the scarves.
Take some photos. If you guys just wouldn't mind find it not for our social media, if you guys could put on a star.
I'm glad I didn't bring it with me.
That's my question. It's not the legislature's job to authorize charter schools, but we only saw one authorized in the state of New Jersey, where half the enrollment rate percentage-wise of the national average for charter school enrollment. What kind of legislative fixes? What's the problem? What's the logjam? Are there legislative fixes that can make sure that we allow more of this demand to be met, like, for example, multiple charter authorizers or some sort of other streamlining for helping people apply?
Clearly, multiple charter authorizers is a key component of that. There should be, I mean, most other states have at least two. We should follow their lead, and whether that's a Rutgers or a number of entity on this, as a secondary authorizer, we need to go down that path. So I think multiple authorizers make some sense. And having a system where people know what the process is in the executive branch makes even better sense as well. But you also, I think, getting to the point where Michael Patrick mentioned earlier, one of the great successes of charter schools is there many are doing an extraordinary job, and those that aren't have the opportunity to leave the stage, and that's a very important part of this, of the factors we have with charter schools is when they succeed they're extraordinary. When they don't succeed, parents can pursue another opportunity, and those entities can close, and that's the responsibility of the state to make sure that the ones that are working can continue to succeed, and those that aren't working are leave.
But what in the whole state for the year is a frozen system, right? There's something wrong.
This governor, in his first charter authorization, I think authorized more charters than all of his predecessors combined, I think, or some statistics like that. Sometimes a year is a year, depends on who applies, right? I mean, if I haven't seen every single school that applied, but if you had a situation in this system where it just happened to one qualified, I mean, let's make sure that those that get authorized are qualified. So I can't speak to the merits or demerits of each of these entities, but I do know that this governor, among others, is very supportive of the charter school. Charter education system has spoken on it, wants to do a lot this year. My hope is the legislature will partner with him on that. But let's just not use a one-year statistic. Let's look at the overall focus of this administration. And this administration has been focused on charter schools. They've been focused on school choice. They've been focused on, my hope is, continuing to focus on ways to change school funding formula to have much more of an outcomes-based approach, including making sure that special education reform is part of that process.
I think the bottom line is the bottom line. And I think that part of that recognition is where initiation within government comes from and where reaction comes from. And traditionally, the legislature is, in fact, a reactive branch. And the executive is the initiating branch. A small secret, I didn't vote for Governor Christie when he first ran, and I didn't vote for him when he ran a second time. Nonetheless, when he first ran, and when he ran again, charter schools were a major part, or some part, of his oratory, of his program, of his platform. As a matter of fact, I think that all of us, to some degree or another, were gratified by his mention of charter schools in his recent State of the State. But I think that one, nonetheless, is concerned because despite that oratory, one has not really seen the kind of growth within charter schools that one would hope and expect. I think that Tom, as he usually is right on the mark. Are there other authorizers who might be contemplated? Certainly that is one way to go. Do we need better oversight of charter schools, not only for the oversight ability, but so that the public will better understand that charters are indeed subject to those concerns? And that's good for us as a charter school community, if you'll allow me to join you in that, right? But I think that realistically, one has to understand that there are just so many legislative fixes that it is up to the administration to initiate. And unfortunately, we've not received the kind of progress that we had thought that we would when Governor Christie first took over. And that's not a criticism of him. There's any number of things that come up. Certainly this is one of any number of priorities. But I think in trying to be fair to him and to us, it's out there.
I can criticize. What I want to point out is that the number of people working in the Department of Education keeps on going down, and the charter school office gets smaller and smaller. The report that was due many years ago on charter schools and their success or possible failures, but their success, has never been issued by the department, whether it's under a Democratic administration or a Republican administration. And that's due to the lack of personnel that exists as the department gets smaller and smaller, and there's not the people to do the job. And that's a criticism of the process that we presently are in, and the budget problems that exist, and the need for an understanding of how do you go about having the necessary people to authorize the charter schools and then to evaluate them.
I got a question. My name is Titus Pierce. I'm running for governor here in New Jersey. My website's titusrpierce.com. I got two of them. One, I want to know about the Opportunity Scholarship. All right. And then second, I want to know how you guys build, how could you guys get behind a regional school districting system for the entire state, going from 565 school districts to 590%, and then consolidating somewhere into about the 300-325 district mark. We're looking at shared resources in terms of how do we pay the bill for this. You guys are talking about managing the funding formula. I'm talking about let's manage the funding formula and let's look at shared resources. Can I put 40 square miles and five counties together, and instead of having everybody pay $14,000, now I can have people paying $87,000.
What's the question?
That is the question.
Okay, that's the question. Okay.
Going into a shared resource and regional school districting plan statewide, that's question one. And question two is, what are the underpinnings of the Opportunity Scholarship?
Okay. Thank you.
I think the speaker should mention the Opportunity Scholarship Act since it was his, and we just carry on his legacy. But the premise of it is in those school districts or school buildings that are failing their students on all the assessments, the language arts and the math assessments, to if they're doing both and they're failing, 40% are failing. Or in one standard, 60% of students are failing, in that specific school building, you would create a system where there would be a school choice mechanism created using state dollars to say those students would have an opportunity to go somewhere else, whether it's another public schools, whether it's a parochial school, whether it's a private school, whatever it is, at a certain baseline. I've reintroduced a piece of legislation, it's the Opportunity Scholarship Act. You can check it out. But it's supposed to be an acute solution for an immediate problem, because certainly public schools in every single zip code, I mean, every building in a zip code aren't failing. The question is, in a specific building, those kids can't wait 12 years, 14 years for educational reform to impact that specific building. Let's have an acute solution. That's the Opportunity Scholarship Act in a nutshell. Regarding regionalization, I think that we've sometimes come to see that bigger is not always better. And if you're looking at something that is so acute to the future of families, all hopes and dreams that are embodied in their kids, simply regionalize, creating something that's larger for their kids is not necessarily always the best outcome. On a different issue, I get hit all the time about my comments regarding county government. And some counties do a good job and some don't, but they're frequently, you know, I don't understand why North Plainfield, South Plainfield, and Plainfield are in three different counties. So you got to look at, for example, those anachronisms of history need to be looked at. So if you can figure out ways to create better value through purchasing, through other things, let's focus on ways to get accountability within the system. But especially in education, bigger is not always better.
So that's a resounding yes, because you're saying we can pool to share resources, but maybe
of course, anything you can do to share resources and opportunity and those efforts make all the sense in the world, because that's just the market system working. To, you know, bigger purchases mean you drive down costs. But the question in the end is that you've got to figure out what's in the best interest of the students, and sometimes bigger is not better. And frequently, bigger is not better in the interest of
education. We don't need
education.
A back and forth. Thank you. Thank you.
Let me.
Next question.
Follow. I mean,
Assemblyman Carroll.
I'm quiet. I've been deferring to the senator, but I mean, I'm not going to defer right now because
no,
I'm,
no
I'm
problem.
Touch bases. Just on the subject of regionalization, you got to be real careful what you wish for, because leave aside the bigger isn't necessarily better. Control isn't necessarily there. And when you have, say, five towns in a regional district, under our present system, usually they're contributing to the overall fund for the schools based upon their property values. And as a result, you sometimes, over time, have a situation where one town will, say, prosper or grow, another town won't. And so you'll have one town spending $25,000 on a kid, and another town sending the kids to the same schools only spending $8,000 per kid. And that's a problem. I mean, it can create some real, and furthermore, with tax abatements, for example, my own hometown of Morris Township is merged with Morristown, as far as the schools are concerned. When Morristown offers a tax abatement to an apartment complex, the result is they get all the money from the pilots. The schools don't get any. And as a result, the burden falls upon Morris Township to educate all those new kids in that school, or that from that apartment complex. It's a problem. So if you're going to look at regionalization, I would suggest that you go a step further and look at consolidation. While bigger isn't always better, sometimes it is. And perhaps, I mean, from my perspective, for example, I look at my own hometown of Morris Township. Completely surrounds Morristown. It's a donut. You cannot get out of Morristown except by air without going through Morris Township. And we also share schools already with Morris Plains. Why not merge all those three towns into one? You could have, instead of, well, I guess, eight firehouses, you could have five. Instead of three police stations, you have one. It could be done, but it has to be done in such a fashion as to ensure that the people today don't see a huge tax increase from one town to another, or because usually, inevitably, a regionalization or a consolidation benefits one town more than it does another. And someone's going to pay more, someone's going to pay less, and the people who pay more vote. So just as a caution, you got to be careful when you try and propose something like that.
Let me add further to that some unexpected fuel to the fire. Number one, congratulations on your run for the nomination for governor. I don't know what party you're running for, but congratulations. Okay.
He's one of yours.
I've got one in the audience. It's all right.
Maybe you can vote for him.
I think that this concept of regionalization is one which speaks to a fundamental problem in terms of New Jersey schools and perhaps in terms of New Jersey government as a whole. And the question is translating the philosophical into the practical. The practical is that in so many towns that are wealthier towns, the education is better, the kids are more prepared for any number of reasons. It's not simply economics. And in so many other schools where children are not doing well, where schools are crumbling, where test results are poor, it's because those are economically disadvantaged areas. As we all know, the juxtaposition of a wealthy school district literally next door to a poor school district, right? That's literally what's occurred in New Jersey. One is understanding of the fact that people oftentimes choose where to live by virtue of the quality of the school system. My son and daughter-in-law just moved to Essex County for what was the primary consideration they looked for were the best schools possible. Next to their school district is an urban school district, right, where the test results are tremendously different. I think that if we're looking to a problem, one of the problems is that we don't have regionalization, because poor kids will do better when they're sitting in the same classrooms as rich kids, or at least middle class kids. We know that for a fact. There have been any number of studies which have proved it time and time again. The current system, I would suggest to you, is promoting disparity, and I'm trying to be generous at best. I would suggest that it perhaps is promoting racism, certainly economic segregation. There's no question about it. And so often, as we know, again, economy and race also issue outcome as well. So I think there's a fundamental challenge. Now, the problem is translating that philosophy into the practicality. We're going to suddenly decide that instead of almost 600 school districts, we're going to have 100. Is that practical? Is the city of Clifton, which is a block away from where I live, and very, very different in every respect possible, going to agree to merge with the city of Passaic in terms of its school district? Well, they didn't want to merge with us in terms of fire departments. They didn't want to merge with us in terms of police departments. Something tells me that they would not want to merge with us in terms of school systems, even more so. So you've got some fundamentals at play there. And if you want to speak about the problem, the elephant in the room when one speaks about schools and school funding, it is the fact that we are not regionalized, that we are not blending together people from different cultures, backgrounds, religions, faiths, economics, and thereby looking at a better result.
This will be the last question.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm Mark Silverstein. I'm superintendent of schools in Glassboro, Gloucester County. I'd like to bring the conversation back to inter-district public school choice for a minute if I can. And I appreciate Senator Kean's comment about the free market system. We've had a very successful school choice program. We were one of the first districts that jumped on when it came about. And ours is a little bit different. Ours is a theme-based program tied in with Rowan University. We've been stymied because of the school choice caps at the moment. And we thought outside the box, and we know there's a legislative hurdle right now that schools of choice are not able to charge tuition to bring in additional seats to fund students as we are doing in Glassboro. So I'm really appealing to the legislature's help to really get that removed, because if we're not going to remove the caps, if we remove the tuition barrier, that would open it up for us. Right now, for every choice student that comes into Glassboro, we are able to fund three Glassboro students to go to Rowan University and take college credits right on campus. That was the whole purpose of a program like this. We really need the legislature's help to open that up for us.
First and foremost, welcome north. It's a long drive this morning for you. I look forward to working with you in more detail to better understand how you get to that, because I was one of the prime sponsors of the inter-district school choice program, and I'd love to talk to you about ways to make it even better.
Okay. That was a short one. So anybody else? Okay, this is the last one.
Okay.
Go ahead. Right there.
Okay. My name is Dawn. I'm not running for governor. I'm the chief growth officer at Eiler Schools in North Jersey. But I have a question. After listening to Commissioner Hespe say the goal is to reach 50,000 students, and Bob mentioned the barriers of multiple authorizers, I think the elephant in the room is really the access to equitable funding, facility funding, and being able to find facilities. A lot of times we're searching to open schools in urban areas. It's not like office space and school space is abundant. And sometimes, you know, we might lock, you know, with the public school district wanting the same facility. There's no priority given to charters. And being a public school, sometimes we really do feel like the second class citizens in the room. So is that ever anything that's addressed, is actually the inequity with facilities funding? Because I think that's really important.
I agree. I sponsored a bill for many years that would equalize the facilities funding, and we certainly need to do that. I bet Joe Doria probably did that too.
I share your thoughts and your concerns on the matter. We had explored at one point possibly opening up EDA funding to charter schools for facilities development. We've run into some stumbling blocks. We're still trying to look to see if it's something that can be pursued. I mean, the issue, of course, in urban areas is lack of space, right? And because of lack of space, obviously space goes at so much more cost per foot, and that raises issues. It also brings us back to our concept of regionalization, however, when in fact the main area that one is looking to get students from is that specific district, rather than opening up regionally. There are some charter schools, at least one that I can think of offhand, where less than 50% of its kids come from the municipality in which it's domiciled, right? And that raises other specters in terms of funding and community response and community need, and speaks perhaps to the greater issue of that regionalization formula. But certainly it is an extraordinary difficult hurdle, to expect the charter schools, which are getting hopefully the 90 cents, and of course it's not 90 cents, in some cases it's closer to 62 cents, even in this great municipality where we're sitting right now. But how do we make buildings affordable for them with which to operate?
Wait, closing statement.
Okay. Thank you. I want to thank our panelists. Thank you. And.